In Southern California, the sun rises over San Diego Bay. Next to a major road in this parking lot, 54-year-old Maria begins her day.
Straighten my bed.
This car is her home.
This is every day. This routine about stretching my bed.
Maria no longer has a place to live. She has been sleeping in her van for a year now.
Looks pretty nice. It doesn't seem that you live here, but you do. I have seen people with their cars so messy and things all over the place. And how can I go to work with my life like that? I mean, has to have a little order, you know, because this is what we need to continue. It's not that perfect, but it's the way I want, and makes me feel better.
Just like Maria, around 30 other people sleep overnight in their cars in this free parking lot. Nevertheless, most of them work. They are security guards, Uber drivers, secretaries, or even computer technicians. Maria is a cleaner and a carer, exhausting work that she does 7 days a week. To provide some comfort for all these people, an organization has supplied them with a water point, portable toilets, and a small outdoor kitchen where Maria prepares her morning coffee before going to work.
This kind of bulletproof coffee. It's very famous in the United States.
Maria's fall from grace is a situation that affects thousands of other Americans. For a long time, she had everything she always wanted. She was married and lived in this beautiful house. But after 5 years of living together, her blissful marriage suddenly fell apart.
He kind of dumped me. He said, okay, it didn't work, bye-bye. Okay, bye-bye, see you later. I said, what? No, I don't have a place, no home. I'm a homeless. No bed, no furniture, no house, so. It's just my car. I have a seat here. And that's the way it is.
Maria preferred to leave everything to her ex-husband and turn over a new leaf. But over the last several years in California, the cost of rent has risen so much that her salary, the equivalent of 1,500 euros, was not enough for her to afford an apartment. Maria is just one of many middle-class Americans who have, in recent years, fallen into poverty. Officially, America is great again. Since the 2008 crisis, the economy has never been stronger, with record-breaking growth. And unemployment has dropped to a historical low, less than 4%. An upturn for which Donald Trump has claimed all the credit.
There has never been a better time to start living the American dream.
But despite what the president claims, the famous American dream is far from being achieved. 40 million people are living below the poverty line, and millions of workers will go to great lengths to stay above it.
You get money? Are you familiar with plasma? You give, okay. I do that twice a week.
Becoming homeless overnight is what these Americans fear most, because here, the system is not very kind to those short of cash.
You better catch up real quick, or you're going to have a judgment of possession against you and get addicted.
In some states, being late on your rent is no laughing matter.
Sheriff's office.
One by one, tenants are evicted at gunpoint.
Where am I going to sleep? I can sleep in a hotel if I need to.
For these Americans on the verge of ruin, seeking medical treatment can cost a fortune.
It's hard to eat. and take your medicine too, because you may not get one or the other.
So some people are standing up in solidarity, making sure they're taken care of free of charge in field hospitals, not unlike those found in a country at war. An insight into the lives of those who cannot scrape a living in the heart of destitute America. San Diego in Southern California. 300 days of sunshine a year and beaches as far as the eye can see. This is Picture Postcard California. San Diego is also one of the most dynamic cities in the country. Here, unemployment is practically non-existent. This dream lifestyle was once an everyday reality for Eric. He was a successful computer engineer, earning 7,000 euros a month. Today, at 53 years old, this man lives alone in his car. And in order to eat for free, he has made an arrangement with the staff at a pizzeria.
Hello. How are you today?
Good, and you?
Good.
Here to pick up the
sandwiches?
Yep. I made that up for you.
Thank you.
What do you take here?
These are the slices that they have in their display that they have them for too long, then they put them in the fridge for me so that they donate them.
Eric comes every evening to pick up some leftover pizza.
Well, thank you very much.
You.
Very
day.
Much appreciate it.
See you tomorrow.
Okay, bye-bye.
He's going to share these unsold slices with other victims of poverty. Because for a year and a half, Eric has been sleeping in this parking lot, the one where Maria, the cleaner, also lives. His pizza deliveries make his neighbors very happy.
That's a lot.
Like Lirella, a 55-year-old Uber driver.
Looks good.
You hungry?
Yeah, we're hungry.
Did you eat today?
No.
No?
No, I had a drive all day today.
In his former life, Eric also worked a lot, 50 hours a week. But 4 years ago, he suffered a burnout and also problems with his heart. He could not work and received unemployment benefits for 6 months. And then, nothing at all.
I thought I could handle it. I thought I would get better. But it took a toll. And after several years of just dealing with doctors and burning through my savings, I ended up basically burning through everything and couldn't afford to stay in an apartment any longer.
Eric is trying to pick himself up. Nowadays, he's doing temporary work and is saving up to be able to rent an apartment. After her long day at work, Maria is back.
You tired?
Yeah. Yeah. It's where I work is a little hard because I have to lift a lady. She's very heavy. Back and forth. But 9 hours is not. It's a lot of hours. But I'm okay. Thirsty, my food, my bed. I'm ready to jump in my bed. Becomes very tired.
At 9:30 at night, the gates close. From this point onward, no more cars can enter the parking lot. At night, there isn't a security guard. There haven't been any attacks here to date, but Maria doesn't take any chances.
I close the door, put the windows down, like this much, and put the alarm. If somebody's trying to break in, I will know. I got my pepper spray. And I have my cutter. Somebody's trying to break in? Psh! Spray. Yeah, because you never know. That's it.
A few meters away, Eric is getting ready to spend another night in his car, even though it's full to the brim. The former computer engineer will sleep sitting behind the wheel. It's a world away from the comforts of his old life.
And one thing that I've really found out about this is that, you know, the typical stereotype of you know, the homeless person being lazy and not wanting to work or being a drug addict. That may be the case in some places and some, but the people I've come through in this program, most of them are very hardworking, people that want to get ahead, that have either have some health issues or have had a streak of bad luck, or for whatever reason, they've, you know, come into this situation. Some people are able to get out of it quickly. Some people it takes longer.
California is a state of stark contrasts. Despite being the fifth largest economy in the world, a growing number of its workers can no longer afford a place to live. But there is another state where the system is even more unforgiving. That state is Virginia, right next to Washington, D.C. Its capital, Richmond, is a former industrial city. Here, a quarter of the population live beneath the poverty threshold. Of the 10 major cities with the highest rates of eviction in the country, half are located in Virginia. In Richmond alone, around 3,000 tenants are forced out of their homes every year. The evictions are a routine job for Officer Loyal from the Sheriff's Office. Several times a week, he distributes the dreaded yellow notices. In the state of Virginia, the law is strict. If the rent is late by 5 days, the landlord has the right to begin the eviction process. The threatened tenants have 1 week to settle their debts. Otherwise, they face eviction by force. And Officer Loyal does not show much sympathy. This morning, he and his colleagues have to evict the residents of this house.
Sheriff's Office!
And just like when arresting a dangerous criminal,
Sheriff's Office,
they enter the home with their guns drawn.
I'll take it back.
Okay.
Sheriff's Office!
The tenant is not currently at home, and clearly, they've not had time to vacate the premises.
Mr. Chenault, you're okay to change the locks out.
As for the landlord, he immediately reclaims his property.
Check everything?
I'm checking the windows now.
Why?
To make sure the house is secure.
The tenant has arrived and is in shock. She had been renting the house for 7 years. A single mother to a grown-up daughter, she works, but has frequently struggled to make ends meet. She has to pick up her belongings the next day, otherwise everything will go to the junkyard at her expense.
It's just going to be easier on you, like the vehicle that's in the backyard or whatever, if you have it removed, because if he has a tow company remove it, then that's an added expense that you'd be looking at.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, that's fine.
Do you think all this is a little bit harsh?
Do I think it's harsh? No, he got to do what he got to do, and I got to do what I got to do.
And where are you going to sleep?
Where am I going to sleep?
Yeah.
I can sleep in a hotel if I need to.
A hotel?
Yeah, I can. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Have a good day.
She's immediately rendered homeless. No room for negotiation.
This is the only way to make the tenant move?
That's up to her, if that's the only way. She said she would move before this. Didn't move.
Maybe she had nowhere to go.
She never did say that to me.
There are around 10 evictions just like this one every day in Richmond. As a consequence of this fast-track justice, budget hotels on the outskirts of the city have become a refuge for those who've been kicked out of their homes. Some people stay there for a very long time. Among them is David, a 38-year-old gardener.
What's going on, man?
How are you?
Same old, new day.
David has lived in this motel since his eviction 2 years ago. At the weekend, the divorced father's children come to stay over in his one-room home, which cost him €1,300 a month.
This is it, man. This is our bedroom, living room, family room, every room. This is the little kitchen, which I cooked her eggs last night and made hamburgers, so I ain't cleaned the dishes yet. You know, we hung out, played video games. And bathroom, you know, got a shower. But that's about all.
During the week, David shares this single room, which is packed with household utensils and personal possessions, with his new partner.
Is it not too hard to live for 2 years here?
Oh, man, I'm like cramped, you know. Like, obviously, if you put two people in the same room for a long enough time, you're going to bump heads and have arguments and stuff.
His girlfriend has a stable job in the insurance business. They could buy a bigger and less expensive apartment, yet they remain trapped in this tiny room because their past eviction continues to haunt them.
At the time, she was trying at first, and then you get so beat down by going to places and stuff and they're not giving you a place because they're like, oh, you had an eviction. Shows that you didn't pay this like 2 months or something like that. And it definitely was detrimental to it. You know, there was no way of getting anywhere.
It's almost unthinkable in many parts of the world, but here landlords are able to access the past of bad tenants with a few simple clicks. A systematic surveillance system that has been denounced by Martin Wegbright, a lawyer and defense attorney for tenants.
So, this database is a public database. I mean, anyone can go on to this database and look at it, and you can search by name. So let's try a common American name. Here we go. Oh, Mary Gillespie. Okay. There we go. And you can see 5 unlawful detainers. Let's see.
10 years ago, this tenant had a series of late payments. Despite being small amounts, in this case under $300, they can have grave consequences.
So if I'm a landlord, I can look at that and say, well, that was 10 years ago, but I think she's too much of a risk. I don't want to rent to her. If anything bad happens to you, whether it's, you get your hours cut back at work, whether you break an ankle and you're off work for a month, whether you got that car repair bill or that hospital bill or anything that just throws your budget off slightly, you better catch up real quick or you're going to have a judgment of possession against you and get evicted. So the tenant really is living under the sword of Damocles.
David is far from an isolated case. 6,300 people are evicted across the U.S. every day. In the city, finding accommodation is the chief source of anxiety. But there's a region where, for some, the main worry is simply being able to put food on the table. Welcome to rural America, the Appalachian Mountains region that spans several states in the eastern part of the country. Appalachia was once widely known for its coal production. These days, almost all of the mines are closed. It's often said that the American dream got lost somewhere along the way here. The Appalachia region, with a predominantly white population, is home to some of the poorest counties in the entire country. During the summer, at lunchtime, this food truck travels up and down the disadvantaged areas of Roanoke. Luz and Stacy are two volunteers who give out free meals to children. They serve up to 200 meals a day, and every time they arrive, they're eagerly awaited. On today's menu, a sandwich, a carton of milk, and a kiwi.
You want roast beef?
In this family, both parents are unemployed. They receive 1,200 euros of welfare a month, but as a family of 5, it's barely enough to live on.
Well, I try to get in at least 2 to 3, but towards the end of the month when the stamps run low, I'll maybe eat one.
One a day. For example, now we are at the end of the month.
Yes, one a day.
One a day?
Yes.
Which one?
I usually skip breakfast and lunch, and breakfast and lunch, and then I eat dinner. So that's all
only
I can
dinner.
Yes, only dinner.
Being poor to the point of starving.
See you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow, Stacey.
Bye.
Au revoir. You too.
This reality is nothing new in the Appalachia region. During his 1964 election campaign, Lyndon B. Johnson visited Appalachia and was horrified by the poverty he saw. After his re-election, he launched a master plan to put an end to poverty.
Today, here and now, declares unconditional war on poverty in America.
One of his ideas was to create food stamps, coupons given free of charge to the poor. To this day, the government distributes these food stamps to 40 million American people. In this mobile home park in the heart of Appalachia, the majority of families benefit from this food aid. With the American flag hanging from the front steps, this is the mobile home of 58-year-old Sirenia Collins. A former Marine, Sirenia no longer works following a long-term illness. She receives a pension of 700 euros. She faces a daily struggle to get by. And her financial difficulties have gotten worse since she took in her niece. Jennifer is an unemployed single mother who has three children to take care of. Leah, Lindsay, and Jaden. Fortunately, Jennifer receives food stamps.
Every month, on the first day, according to how many kids you have and your income, they put, you know, so much on there. And I get, every month on the first, I'll get like $640.
Just to buy food?
Just for food, yeah.
560 euros a month to feed five people, a tight budget. Before going shopping, the two women check the balance on their card.
Your SNAP balance is $62.38.
Sirenia and Jennifer can spend their food coupons in any supermarket, like this discount store where they regularly go shopping. Once at the checkout, the food stamp card works just like any other credit card. And in this store in Appalachia, they are by no means the only ones who use one.
How many people pay with food stamps here?
Probably half the people coming here. Mm-hmm.
It's a lot?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Donald Trump plans to cut down on the amount of food stamp recipients. Critics say that risks making an already vulnerable society even poorer. But ironically, here they voted 80% in favor of Trump, and their support for him continues seemingly unabated. To earn a little extra cash, Sirenia does household chores for her neighbors. For a few dollars, she also cuts James's hair. He works in a mine and is a loyal Trump follower.
I am a Trump fan, yeah. I do support Trump.
Why?
Because he's done everything he said he'd do. You know, Trump is willing to help other countries, but his country comes first. That's not happened in a long time. Donald Trump is a billionaire. Donald Trump keeps his family everywhere he goes. His children, his wife are everywhere with him. That tells you a lot about a person.
That unwavering support can be difficult to understand for outsiders. Because since Trump's election, everyday life for individuals in Appalachia has not improved. Poverty is pervasive here and has led to some strange developments. In the middle of the night in this small town, dozens of cars enter a showground.
Pull over right over here, right now.
If you'll turn right here.
Sold out, okay? I suggest that you be back here about 3 or 4 o'clock.
Well, it kind of trips you out because it makes you think it's like it's everybody's lining up like you're going to a concert and you get there and just keep your teeth drilled on or something, you know?
What these people are gathering for here en masse is simply to see a doctor, because every year here, for a weekend,
All you're going to get in this line is medical only.
A nonprofit organization arranges free consultations.
Oh, there is the huge need. A lot of our families in this area are the working class families. They're struggling to choose between paying for medicine that can save their life or, you know, groceries for the week. So it's a shame to have to do it this way, but you got to take care of your people. And these are our people, and this is the way we take care of our people.
We made it through it.
Even though the healthcare system improved under previous President Barack Obama, 28 million Americans remain without any insurance coverage. Sirenia has arrived with her family, her niece Jennifer and her three children. They all need to see the dentist. Medical fees in the U.S. are the most expensive in the world and unaffordable for a large section of the population. So staying up all night seems like a small price to pay.
But I mean, you struggle to have medical assistance.
Yeah, it's not easy. Not easy.
But you have to do it.
Absolutely. The alternative is not a good thing. So, have to.
The family arrived the night before, because here the rule is first come, first served. At 6 o'clock in the morning, the doors open. The organizers call up patients by their number.
127. Somebody's sound asleep in the car, ain't they? 128. So next time we'll call in groups of 20 again, all right?
Once inside, the patients find themselves in a full-scale field hospital, images reminiscent of a humanitarian disaster. And yet this is modern-day America. Here, people are treated in turn by a host of volunteers, nurses, family doctors, but also specialists who are able to treat more complicated illnesses. The most remarkable part takes place in this sports hall, transformed into a gigantic dental care facility. All day long, 60 dentists scale, drill, fill, and remove teeth. As she surveys the scene, Sirenia is overcome with emotion.
It's beautiful. All the people volunteering, and so many people getting help that need it. Before my sister passed away, she had all of her teeth taken out, and she didn't have any teeth to replace them with. And she was younger than I am now, and she was my older sister, so I think about what she went through with health issues because of her teeth, and they're important. Oh my God.
She'll be seen to by a young student soon to complete his medical degree. Before treating Sirenia, he's had time to familiarize himself with the job.
Are you numb up there right now?
How many tooths did you extract today? Have you extracted today?
I've extracted about 15 teeth today.
15?
Yep, myself, yeah. So.
It's a lot?
Yeah.
Pretty good day.
Yeah, it's a pretty good day, yeah.
He will spend a quarter of an hour removing Sirenia's tooth, his 16th of the day.
What do you feel?
Like I have a big mouth.
But there's no time to take a breather here. Sirenia now proceeds to the locker rooms.
You got her.
I got her. Right. Come on, Miss Collins.
Take care, Miss Collins.
Thank you. God bless. Thank you for everything.
A dental prosthesis studio. Like the rest of the temporary facility, it's run by volunteers and funded by donations.
Relax. No, lay your head back. Just relax your lips. Relax.
First, patients have dental impressions made in this room. And next door, a new set of teeth is created in less than 2 hours. Sirenia can look forward to showing off her new smile.
There we go. How's that feel?
Awkward, but okay.
Yeah.
Oh my God, it has teeth.
You have teeth. All the way back, yeah. You're welcome, darling.
I want a big smile. Cheese!
There you go.
You're good. Thank you.
And know that I can smile and feel it. That's what I want. That's what I need. Yes.
If the family had paid for all this treatment, it would have cost them over $3,000. Fortunately, in the United States, there are people personally taking action to help those in need. On the other side of the country, a man has embarked upon a mission to combat the poverty that has plagued the sidewalks of his city, a place usually associated with the rich and famous, rather than the down and out.
And this is Los Angeles, Los Angeles and Hollywood.
38-year-old Elvis is appalled at how conditions in LA have continued to deteriorate in recent years.
It's not a third world country. It's one of the richest countries in the world. It's almost like a movie prop. It's hard to fathom that, like, every single day, this is how people live.
Los Angeles, the sprawling city of angels, and the glamorous heart of Hollywood cinema. And yet today, it is the homeless capital of America. Here, in the last few years, the number of people without a home has increased from 33,000 to 59,000. In the shadows of the city's skyline is the dark side of the Californian dream.
When I was a kid and lived here, it was nothing like it is now. I left for almost two decades, and I came back a few years ago, and it just blows my mind. It's just going to increase because every month the cost of everything keeps going up. There's no regulation, so apartment owners and landlords can raise the money, you know, the rent, whenever they like, but nobody's paychecks are getting bigger.
Outraged by the growing destitution, Elvis gave up his job as a sales assistant. He lives on the salary of his partner, Leah, who works at a university. In this way, Elvis can devote all his time to helping those less fortunate. A little further from downtown, a woman has moved in beneath this bridge. Elvis and Leah regularly pay her a visit.
I'll just leave your car.
All right, baby.
Kami has been living here for 5 years in a small tent that she shares with another woman. They're desperately vulnerable to the dangers of the street and have already been assaulted several times.
But just look at it everywhere. They just tore it right open. And now she doesn't even have a door. When she sleeps out here at night, there's also no lights right under here, so it's very dark. And, you know, especially as a woman, that's pretty damn scary. Even if a guy, it's scary because anybody can walk up in the dark, walk right in, do whatever they want.
To help these people, Elvis wants to do more than just bring them bottles of water. His main project is hidden away in the yard of this church. He came up with the idea to build small wooden houses for the homeless. They're very small. But inside, Elvis and Leah have thought of every last thing to improve the daily lives of these people.
Window alarms?
Yes.
So what does it mean?
So if someone tries to open the window, the alarm will go off. This right here allows people to sleep. When people sleep, they can think, they can do better. They feel better, they want better.
The house is also equipped with a fire alarm, a light, and a phone charger, all of which are powered by a solar panel. Each cabin costs the equivalent of 1,000 euros, financed by donations collected online. But Elvis's well-meaning initiative is illegal. The mayor of Los Angeles has banned him from installing his cabins on the sidewalks of the city. Elvis will carry on regardless. This morning, he's delivering one of them to a homeless couple who very much need it.
Hey.
Hi.
I'm Elvis.
Hi, I'm Krista.
Nice to meet you.
This is our dog, Brownie.
Hi, Brownie.
Krista is a 32-year-old and is 3 months pregnant. She lives on the curb of the sidewalk with her partner, Andre.
Love you, my nigga. I love you.
How are you?
God, man.
I was hoping you weren't going to be gone long.
That's the mother to be.
For 4 years now, the couple have been sleeping in this tiny cart that is a health hazard on wheels.
Yeah, man, it's like bed bugging. I mean, it's eating me alive, man. Like I said, you can, everything, all these little different marks, man, it's from mostly not being able to have good hygiene.
Elvis can't hang around.
The trick is to get this done and off before the cops show up.
The tiny house weighs 400 kilograms. But his project does not make everyone happy.
Why don't you go back in your house and enjoy the air conditioning?
A neighbor expresses her discontent.
She's against this.
Why?
She doesn't want it in front of her house.
She's calling the police, and so we need to hurry along, and we'll pray that they are allowed to keep their house. This is how it goes in Los Angeles. Yeah.
Man. Praise God. Thank you.
Good luck to both of you. Yeah. Congratulations.
A few days after filming, the police threatened to destroy the cabin unless Elvis removed it. He and the couple managed to move it onto privately owned land. In the end, the disgruntled neighbor got her way. But we find people elsewhere trying to challenge the ostracization of homeless people in rather inventive ways. Our next stop is Texas and the conservative city of Waco. It has around 50 churches serving its 120,000 residents. Here, once a month, a religious community organizes a curious program. People come from all over the United States to take part.
Do you know what's going to happen for you?
Not really. No idea.
A little bit.
What do you know?
We're going to be homeless.
For 24 hours, these high school students are going to live, eat, and sleep in a role-playing scenario, much like 20 or so other participants, all from middle-class backgrounds. Each of them has paid €60 to participate. Janet Durrell came up with the idea 25 years ago with her husband, a pastor. The remarkable simulation project has so far had 30,000 participants.
The goal is to create compassionate care for humanity and poverty. Everybody can get the American dream, but when you're trapped in poverty and the cycles of poverty, you have to have an advocate to get you out.
Janet Durrell says in order to truly experience the life of a homeless person, you have to start by looking like them. In this secondhand store, participants are encouraged to dress in appropriate clothes.
Jeans and these little boots. But I think that they'll keep the mosquitoes off of my ankles, so I'm happy about that.
Right now, it doesn't seem like too much of a challenge, but things are going to get more complicated with the second stage, sleeping out in the open, albeit not in the streets, but in a secured, fenced-off yard. 53-year-old Marta, however, is slightly concerned.
You know, I'm scared of bugs.
Bugs?
I'm scared of bugs.
She thought long and hard before signing up. It was her husband who convinced her to take part.
It doesn't look like real homeless situation.
Right. Yes. It doesn't smell like poop. It doesn't smell like urine. There's not rats running everywhere. Yeah, no. This is definitely luxury homelessness. Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
A fact that is a comfort nonetheless, although it won't be a very long night. At 6 o'clock the next day, Janet Durrell gives everyone a wake-up call, and they don't look particularly well rested.
Come on, Martha.
It's not a real homeless situation. They're safe.
They're safer than being on the street, but this is not as safe as being in the home with their family. So it just gives them a little bit more reality of what living in the environment does on your body. So by tonight, it takes about 24 hours to really start getting the idea that this could be really rough.
For the next stage of the program, the participants are sent to downtown Waco. Their task today is to find something to eat on their own and without any money.
You can smell the food.
Yeah. So, should I ask this guy? We can't.
You cannot beg or solicit people at restaurants.
Like in many other cities in the U.S., begging is a punishable offense. It's also forbidden to rummage through garbage bins.
Oh, there's no food in there?
They're city property, and reclaiming anything at all from them is considered stealing. In order to survive, the homeless in Waco are therefore forced to break the law. Our two participants are not going to find anything to eat. And after 2 hours of walking the streets in 40 degrees heat, Marta feels faint. She calls her husband to pick her up.
But I feel like I'm too weak.
Well, you've learned something about yourself.
Like I'm too old and fat and I can't do it.
You've learned something about yourself. And what it would be like to be homeless at your age.
Yeah.
And it'd be hard.
Is the U.S. truly ready to face up to poverty? While the president claims America has never been so great, 40 million of Trump's fellow citizens are still caught in the clutches of poverty.